or something?
Yeah, this mic, yeah. That's what happens when your mic is
on. Yeah, good afternoon. As you said, I'm Ashita. I'm working with Child Guidance Center, CIG Hospital. And today, the topic being child behavior and psychology. Let me just give you a little bit of background, like what exactly we can expect out of the child in terms of fine motor development, language, intellectual, social, and cross motor development, so that, you know, we can set the expectations right. Okay? So yeah, developmental milestones, as we say, we definitely need to have a checkpoint. Reason being, that's going to help us to know more about the child at the expected range. So this is how it goes. Let me start off with 3.5 years, because I suppose the age range that was given to me is between, you know, 2 to 6. Yeah. So let's start off with 3.5 years. Okay. So if it's the fine motor development, maximum what we can expect is the child would draw some basic shapes, okay, can make tower with few cubes, can demonstrate how to wash hands, and probably he can just cut a paper like till the opposite direction. It might not be straight or something, but he can just take the scissor and cut it. Okay. So gross motor development would include balances on one foot for 5 seconds around, runs easily, can ride a tricycle, or use a toilet. Now, toilet training happens between the age of 2 to 3 years. So by 3.5, we do expect that the child would go to the toilet by himself and do the required necessary stuff. Okay. Now, language development. By this time, the child would have 900 words of vocabs, which would include adjectives, prepositions, and everything. It's the total vocab that we see. Then he would be able to talk in sentences of about 9 words. Would ask many questions, wherein the parents do get tired, okay, and would repeat common rhymes, as they are also exposed to schools and also parents at home. They do expose them to a lot of rhymes, and it's the time for them to yak, so they can do that, and they can say sounds like, you know, a, ma, ba, pa, na, la, wa. Okay. Now intellectually, they would be able to repeat 3 numbers. For example, if we say 4, 2, 7, they would hear it out and they would say 4, 2, 7. Okay. Then they would still engage in fantasy play, when they would do a lot of, you know, kitchen game, when they would take the role of mother. Okay, don't do this, don't do that, all those things. Or they will make their own fantasy. Then they can build a tower of 9 to 10 cubes. Socially, they would be more friendly. Then they would begin to understand what is sharing and how to wait for taking turns, like developing a little bit of patience rather than being impulsive. They would also begin to learn meaning of simple rules. When you say that you are supposed to stand here, for example, or simple rules of a game, like after me, it's your turn. Now 4 to 5 years, this is what we expect. Fine motor development. He would unbutton large buttons. Okay. He would wind up toys by turning the knob. Would draw a cross with intersecting lines. So by that age, we do expect that the child would be, you know, good enough with drawing sleeping lines, standing lines. Then he would begin to show the hand preference, whether to use the left hand or the right hand more. Okay. He would be able to draw a person with at least 8 body parts. Probably not that perfect, but yes, he would be able to show these eyes, this is the nose, and all those things. In gross motor development, he would balance 1 foot for 4 to 8 seconds. Previously, it was about 5 seconds at the max. Now here, it would be 4 to 8 seconds at the max. He would jump from a step. He would cut straight with scissors. Now this time, it's straight. It's not just cutting anyway. He can copy a circle. Now by the age of 2.5, we can expect that the child is making some circles kind of a thing, but we cannot expect the perfection. Now by this time, we should expect the perfection, copying a circle. Language development would be, you know, he would ask questions like what, where, who, and not any random questions. He would be more specific about what he wants to ask. He would speak clearly, which is understood by even non-family members. Okay. Now, Next would be, you know, giving reasonable answers to basic questions. Saying the sounds of d, g, f, k, y. Intellectual development would be dressing up and undressing with little help. Then giving first and last name. Counting till 5 at least. And building up a tower of 10 blocks. Now, if the child is exposed more, if it's overstimulation, the child can also speak more than more than counting 5. They can go higher up. Social development would be, you know, showing many emotions, sad, anger, and everything. Like, they would be more expressive and they would be more reasonable. Playing parallel play with other children. Parallel play would be something wherein there are two kids playing. Probably they are not intruding into each other's work, but still interested to know what the other person is doing. So parallelly they are playing. By 5.5, we expect the child to fold the paper in half with edges, then cutting square, connecting the dots in straight line very well, touching each finger to thumb rapidly, colors within lines without crossing lines. Initially, you would see when you are teaching coloring and you are expecting, no, you need to do it properly. It should be within the scene. But probably till 5.5, you would not see that perfection, which is still okay. You can keep teaching them, but by the time the child is 5.5, you can expect perfection. Then, imitating building a pyramid of cubes. Now, in gross motor development, we can expect that, you know, he skips using alternate feet, catching large balls, bathe self, okay, while he goes to the washroom, the bathroom, basically for taking bath and everything. You can expect that he would do it well and come back. Probably, you know, little bit of help is required. You know, that's out of, okay, fine, mummy kar do. But then you can expect that agar main nahi bhi hu ghar pe, toh probably he'll do it. Then walking backwards from toe to heel. Language development would be, you know, speaking clear sentences, up to 5 to 6 words at least, using all types of sentence structure. Using all adjectives, prepositions. I want a big ball. I don't like the smaller ball. Like, not just saying I don't like the ball, but really using the sense that it's small or big. The perception is created. Intellectual development would be, you know, dressing up alone, counting up to 10 objects, copying familiar shapes like square, triangle, circle, putting objects behind, in front, back, etc. Able to define objects, object use. For example, what is a spoon? If you ask, they would be able to say, okay, this is used for eating, and in proper sentences. Describes objects seen in pictures. Recognizing shapes, numbers completely. Making decisions easily. Social development would be playing with boys and girls, the cooperative play. Likes playing with adults or older children as well. Likes to have a best friend, when you would see that, you know, child comes back home and would say, oh, I have this friend who is my best friend. I be with him most of the time. Developing a sense of right and wrong. Likes small group play and knows right from left. So I gave you the idea till 6, what can we expect. Now probably you can come up with questions so that, you know, I can just have the idea, like, what more do you want to know? Yes.
Who wants to ask questions? Like, it's an interactive session, so you have to ask questions.
So what questions we have posted, can you open it? is possible?
I don't think that's there. Is
yeah,
it
but
there?
You
can ask here.
Question because some
yeah.
questions are very much personal in that. So let's not open that. You have your own question. You know which you ask. You can ask directly over here again.
So how to deal with stubborn kids? Like, you know, most of the times there is a no when we try to have something done from them. So scolding is one way out. Explaining why it is important to do is one way out. So there are various ways. But if it is, it becomes a daily thing to deal with a child who is very stubborn and tends to say no in most of the things, then how do we deal with it?
See, here comes the behavior modification and behavior management, okay? So we need to know the ABC chart. The ABC chart is basically A being the antecedent, B being the behavior, and C being the consequence, okay? So now we need to see when the child is being stubborn, what is the consequence? What is he getting out of it, okay? We need to do functional behavior analysis in that. It could be a sensory consequence that the child is seeking. It could be tangible. It could be attention, okay, or it could be something where he wants to avoid, right? So I'll give you one simple example. A child, the antecedent is basically a child is sent to the field to play. Now the behavior is the child starts hitting others, okay? The consequence is the teacher would send him back to the class. Now there can be two consequences, the two kind of results that might come up. If it's sensory, it could be that the child does not really like heavy noises. So this is how he creates a situation where he would anyways know that the teacher would send me back. So the purpose is served. Second could be that he wants to avoid the situation because heavy noise is upsetting for him. So again, the purpose is served, right? So we need to alter the consequence in stubbornness. Now we as parents, we know that, you know, we become a little weak when it's a child and, you know, the motherly feeling or the parental feeling rather, the child knows how to manipulate. Okay. So you need to be very firm and consistent in the rules and regulations. The first mantra is you need to have fixed rules and regulations wherein you need to put it forward in a very, you know, assertive way that the child gets the point. For example, I'll tell you, okay, a child comes and is like, Mama, I want this, okay? And you say, no. He would say, no, I want this. Then again, you would say, no. And he would start crying, he would start throwing tantrums and everything. But the more you argue, the more you create situation for the child to behave in that particular situation. So when it's a no, you just need to look at him and say, listen to me, it's a no, and you walk out of that place. So it's a double impact when you walk out because the child gets the point that there is this physical impact as well and mother is very firm about it. She's not going to listen to me what I want to say. You walk out of the place and you would still can hear the voice of the child, he's crying outside the room or something. But for how long will he cry? After he reaches the peak, he would come down. All that you need to do is, you need to stay consistent about your decision. And he would get the point. But before that, if you give up, he would know, haan, mummy de degi, main thoda roonga to. So that's what you need to avoid. You need to be very consistent about what you do. What you want, rather.
You mentioned about the rules and regulations. Today, whatever minimum set of rules delivery teaches the child, one thing that I've observed is that the rules are so hardwired into the child, right? There are two angles. One is they don't become very flexible then because of so many rules. And when somebody else breaks rules, even then they get irritated. So the rules are so hardwired. So how do you get that balance?
First thing, you need to know that the child models parents. So if you tell the child that you are not supposed to watch TV at this hour, okay, and you turn on the TV, what message are you sending? What message are you giving to the child? So I'm giving an example, I'm not saying you do it. So it's just an example. So what happens, the child is getting the message that, aray, it's okay to do it because Papa also did it, right? So then there is a confusion that's been created, why me? If this is not right, okay, then why is he doing it? So, you know, we just need to check our behavior as well when we become a parent. Because, you know, the early developmental years, they are very crucial years for the child. Once the child is, you know, around 8, 9 years or 10 years old, he gets the point. So, but then the initial years...
Talking from different angles. So, you know, of course, parents need to follow the same rules. I'm talking about different things. So, say, if, for example, if a child is playing downstairs and some other kids break the rule, and then they get irritated, why are they breaking the rules? These rules are set. It is not supposed to happen that way.
Hmm.
So, how do you handle that? They have to accept that it's okay if somebody else breaks. I'm not supposed to break it.
That's the thing that you need to teach them with social play as well, like the social stories that you say. Okay, so you create a situation when you know you're having a father time with the child, basically. So you know that this is a message that I want my child to know. Okay, so you give a social story. Okay, so when you give a social story, you just make it so interesting, make it so fun that the child gets the point. And he would know that this is something which is appreciated, even if somebody else is breaking the rule. Probably that's not what is expected out of me.
Mm-hmm.
So social stories would help in that case. So, you know, like if he's put in a situation, he would at least try and logic it out to whatever cognitive development he has. And, you know, you should also be always very open wherein you can tell your child that, you know, whenever there is a situation you don't know what to do, you come back and tell me so that I know how to help you out. And so let me also talk about the parenting styles, like, you know, this would also help. Bobarint in 1960 kind of identified four parenting styles. Basically three were identified before and the last one was later. So authoritative, authoritarian, permissive and neglectful. Okay, in authoritative, what happens is the parents, they do have set rules, but at the same time, they sit and talk with the child so that they also get to know what the child wants. The child feels, I'm being heard of. So it's not like we have the rule and we just impose. The child would also know that, you know, like, okay, my father is also ready to hear me out. So that would calm him down and also that would help him to develop decision-making ability. Okay. Now in authoritarian, what happens, like I said, it's been imposed. We have rules and regulations and you have to abide by it, no matter what you feel. Then the child, you know, would start having low self-esteem, because where is he making decision? Everything has been put onto him. In permissive, the parents are like too much into it, as in the sense, like, you know, there are set rules and regulations, but, you know, they're very weak at it. They're not very firm at it. So, you know, bachche ne ek baar bol diya, do baar bol diya, haan, theek hai, kar le. So again, we are creating a confusion in the child. Okay, ki haan, like, we can really, you know, it's flexible and we can do it and everything. So there is no logic or something that they would have. In neglectful, it's like, you know, it's the uninvolved parent. Wherein the parents are too busy, they don't have time to see how the child is developing, what are the child's need and everything. So in this case, the child is forced to be independent without knowing a logic that, you know, why I need to be independent. So again, this is something where, you know, you can see that when they grow up, they might have a lot of personality issues because they're the confused person. Like, you know, they don't know, they never got guidance. So that's how it is. So, and also that, you know, father and mother, they need to have same parenting style so that the child is again not confused, but otherwise the child would again manipulate. Ki papa ne nahi diya, mummy de degi. So, you know, you also need to see if there are set rules and regulations, it's for all at home.
Regarding the scenario that you explained earlier, we need to be assertive and probably show some body language also to match up to what we want to say.
Yeah.
In cases where we are talking about, you know, making a point and walking away, don't we hold the risk of putting across a message that, okay, she's just walking away on me, I'm not being heard, or don't we hold that risk? Or what's the point in talking when she's not even ready to stand and listen to me?
Yes, so it shouldn't be so strict that you say no every time, okay? So there are certain set rules which the child would know ki nahi, this is something wherein, you know, I won't get rid of, like I'll have to do it. Okay, so in that case the child might just try ki bol ke dekhta hu mummy ko, but when you are firm about it, you're just firm about it, because after half an hour you would come back. You know, if the child is behaving well and everything, we don't say good boy or good girl, because when they are doing a mistake, parents, they have unconditional love for kids. So when they are doing a mistake, it's not that we don't love our boy or our girl, it's just the behavior. So when they do something which is appreciated, we say good job rather than saying good boy. So that helps more. So they would more concentrate on the job that they are doing, which will anyways make them a good boy or a good girl. Any more questions?
This comparison with the other child is good or bad? Because we always said that you are doing bad and someone else is doing good. So we always try to explain like that. So
yeah, no, it's not really healthy for the child, because then the child would, you won't even know that the, you know, child would start feeling that, oh, I'm anyways not adequate enough, so I might as well not do it. So you would see a lot of defensive behavior after that, and you would keep thinking that even though I tell him so much, even though I give him the examples of such great people or his friends and all, still he is behaving the other way, because we are actually creating that. So what we need is basically we need to focus on motivating them, which comes from within, and not really, you know, kind of, they can see, like they can watch a lot of videos which are inspirational and everything, but they need to have their own identity.
But they like to like watch only Chota Bhim when it's
the Exactly. So that's why you need to schedule. So if you're, you know, kind of allowing him to watch Chota Bhim, which every child would need, you know, they also need time wherein, you know, they can relax and all, but they need to know ki 10 se 10:30 tak hi main dekh sakta hu. So they cannot, you know, really extend that, and that's again one of the rules that's set at home. So we cannot really, you know, leave it to the infinity that, okay, TV dekh raha hai bachcha, and we come and complain that bachcha sirf TV dekhta hai. So basically we as parents, we need to see that, you know, did we set the rules right?
So my child is over this age bracket, he's actually 9 plus now.
Yeah.
But I have a question that, how do you deal with a distracted kid? When you know something that, this is generally distraction, then it's not necessarily ability or capability. It's just that something that could, specifically when it comes to, you know, homework or something, that can be done in 10-15 minutes, but is stretched to the core of everybody's patience. How do you deal with that?
Again, you need to check the ABC. Like, what is he getting out of, you know, creating that scene?
Okay.
So when is he distracting, like, is he getting the attention of the parents, because the parents are behind him? Nahi, homework kar lo, that could be one thing. Else, it could also be like, you know, he can just avoid it, and probably he would not do it because anyway studies are not interesting. So that could be the thing. So you need to change the consequence again and make it very fun. So there are two mantras of parenting, like, you know, excellent parenting. They are the, it's like two P's, okay? It's play and it's patience. So parents, they need to have a lot of patience. Of course, I know it gets into the nerves, but we cannot help. So because that's what, you know, we need to do. And play, that keeps their mind healthy. It keeps everything interesting. And you won't probably have to put in external effort to motivate them to do anything.
My kid is below this age, he's now, he'll turn 4 now.
Mm-hmm.
So he starts to imitate what he sees on the TV.
Yeah.
If he sees Chota Bhim, he'll jump like Chota Bhim.
Yeah.
How to do? I mean, he stays in daycare.
Yeah.
So now recently he saw that Bajira movie and he starts imitating.
But is it really unhealthy? Like, is he doing it in the social environment wherein, you know, other people, guests are at home, and you are really feeling embarrassed about it?
No, actually he's doing it to the other kids in the daycare. Those kids are not comfortable with that.
Okay, so they're getting scared and all. Yeah, again, you can use social story over here. So wherein, you know, you give him a situation, probably a night time when he's sleeping or something. So mothers, they tend to speak a lot of stories, right? It's also healthy. It's a good sleep hygiene. Wherein, you know, the child goes off to sleep with a very content feeling that the mom is there by the side. And so in that, you can create a lot of social stories that, okay, this is what Ram did, for example. And this is what happened. And you know what? Wow, he got a good job. So that is the thing. So the child would relate, oh, if I do this, probably I'll also get this thing. Rather than, you know, telling him very directly if he's not getting the point.
I just want to know, like, how to maintain the behavior in terms of if the kid is shy, especially,
yeah,
like, the kid is talkative at home, but if someone is new, you know, probably relative or friend is coming, very shy, and
okay, so when the, I mean, you're talking about when the guests come at home?
Yeah.
Okay, so when the guest is at, you know, is at home, so what is the initial behavior? Like, would he go and at least sit?
No, actually, he just hide his face and go inside the bedroom. Not come to in front of them at least for the next 5 to 10 minutes.
And how old is he?
She's around 4.5.
Okay, again, in this case, in the then social story would help.
Suppose I'm sleeping in my baby, and it's around 11:30.
Yeah.
And he wants to, like, Mama, today I did this, and Ayush did this and that, but I'm very tired. So how I should, like, what to do? How to make him sleep?
Why your child is still active at 11:30?
Yes, 11:12. He's not
ready. Yeah, so you need to
saying,
see.
Mama, wake up. And he's just 2.5.
2.5. Okay, so that's what you need to see. His, you know, like, why is the child still 2.5 and he's still active at 11:30? Is it like, you know, he's too excited about certain things? Or, you know, like, what time do you reach back home?
8:30.
8:30.
He stayed in daycare.
In daycare. And does he sleep in the evening or something?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so anyways, the child is active at 11:30. So you need to cut down a little on that behavior. And also that, you know, it's a sleep hygiene behavior as well. You do not really create a very active situation when it's sleep time. Okay, so it should be a little mellowed down, and also, you know, avoid sweet, okay, because that heightens up the glucose level, and anyways 2.5 is too active, so you're adding up to it. And many doctors also say that you can give warm milk.
Okay, so I noticed with my little one, she's about 6, and at home she's the only one around, so she, like, plays queen at all times. But when she goes to school, she becomes very submissive with her friends, and like, she gets bullied very easily, and at home she's absolutely opposite. So is there any way that we can kind of control, or, you know, that kind of a behavior?
You need to teach assertiveness.
Okay. So I don't mean, no one will hit her and things like that, but she tends, you know, even if someone says something, so what, but I want her to be my friend. So that kind of attitude comes in.
She's 6, right? So you can actually do a logical reasoning with her. So you can sit and talk with her, and you can actually use a little, a lot of cognition. Where you can talk to her in a way that, okay, tell me, this is the situation, okay? How do you feel? Okay? And what do you think is appropriate to do in this situation? So let the child think before you really tell her. Okay, and then if you see that, you know, the child is not, of course, you know, 6-year-old would need some guidance, you would say, you know what, this is what is better. You'll see that you feel better after this. So a lot of play helps. Role playing and everything would also help.
She'll know the story, but she may not say, and she'll say, I was not in the mood to say. Similarly, for the exam, like in certain subjects you get A plus, but in certain subjects you do half paper and say I was not in the mood to do the rest. So teachers are aware. I've spoken to the teachers. They are aware that she's like that. It's her mood.
Yeah.
But then how to explain? Because I have explained her the importance of, you know, completing the paper, and how it's like explaining. But what is the better way of doing?
Role play.
Mm-hmm.
So when at home, you give the similar situation and do a lot of role play where, you know, you act like, you know, oh, like, you know, I'm feeling sad, so anyways I'm not going to answer. So then, you know, when you enact the situation and everything, the child would be able to relate, okay, and the child would be able to see that was the consequence of this. Oh, I'm not getting A plus, and if I don't get A plus, mama is sad, you know, mama is not liking it. Do you like mama to be sad? So, you know, you do all those things so that, you know, cognitively, you know, the child gets a little kind of guidance at least. Yeah.
Few things, not related to academics per se, but like drawing, singing, something of that, that we as a parent expect at least minimum basic interest they should show. Few of the activities, you know, kids show very deep interest, but few they hit, let's say singing or something. We don't want them to be a singer or, you know, painter, but at least that basic interest they should show. Sometimes they don't show and hesitate to do that. Then in that case, what should be the creativity we should use as a parent?
See, every child would have their own area of interest, and as they are developing, they're exploring. So probably, you know, what age is your child?
5 years.
5 years. So probably till the age of 5, you cannot really say that, okay, you know, the child would definitely be doing this when he grows up. Okay, so we need to give that room to the child to really explore and pick one what he likes. Because if we expect something and the child is not really interested in that, he would anyways quit when he grows up.
No, I'm not saying that way. I'm saying even during school projects, whatever it is, basic, I mean drawing, so
yeah,
or coloring.
Yeah,
there was a very hesitant to, you know, pick up that color box also. So this type of behavior, well, minimum interest has to be there, not, you know, very interest.
Do you see any aversion towards colors or holding the color or something?
No.
Nothing of that sort,
no.
Right? Okay, then you can tell that, I mean, what exactly do you expect of the child? The child is good at other things, but it's only few things when he is not interested.
Or hesitant.
Hesitant. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Because it's not that the child is not doing anything. The child is doing few things which he likes. Rest of the things, we can give them some room to not really do it. It's okay. Like, few of the kids might not like coloring.
What is the age group after which they try to, you know, do these things at their own? I mean, show their interest in specific areas.
There is no exactly an age group of something, but yes, by 4 or 5, they would start showing their preferences. What they like, what they know, don't like, they'd be pretty verbal about it, which is good.
Yeah, my question is regarding the language development. So I have a kid which is 1 year and 7 months old. So inside the home, we are talking like our mother tongue, and outside the kid neighbors, she is like, everyone is talking in Hindi and like Maya. So does it create difficulty level for her to adopt the language?
It varies from child to child. See, we all, okay, so if I have to say I have been brought up in a place which is not, you know, related to my mother tongue. So I've been exposed to a lot of languages any which ways, but at the end of it, I did develop my mother tongue and the other languages that was been taught. Okay, so it differs from child to child, but if you see that normal development is happening otherwise, it's not too early. Yeah.
Nowadays, like, most of the parents are both are working and kid at home, so the gap of parent timing is more, like, child get less timing with her mother and father at the same time. So how to connect more with the child in that case?
Saturday, Sundays you have off?
Yeah.
So the child is going to look forward for Saturdays and Sundays if you make it a fun time.
Okay.
Daily you need to have some time, like you have a family time together. Probably if you reach before the dinner time, so you can have the family dinner time, right? You know, the child is learning that, okay, these are the family etiquettes and also the attachment. So you can create such situations, or if you are reaching home after the dinner time, like the child has already eaten or something, then you can say that, okay, it's father son time, so let's play half an hour or something. So that's how the attachment goes on.
In the event of a second baby coming, is there anything specific that we should be mindful of with the first one?
I didn't get your question.
So in
really.
The event of a second baby coming,
yeah.
I've heard that you know, the first one becomes very insecure and you know, will start seeking a lot of attention.
Yes.
So as parents and grandparents, is there anything that we can definitely do to ensure that insecurity period goes away?
Yes, you need to involve the child even before the second child comes. So, you know, you need to involve the first child in everything. You know what? See, the baby is going to look like this. So you show visual pictures and all. So if it's a baby boy, this is how it's going to look. If it's a baby girl, this is how it's going to look. And you know what? Mama and you will do a lot of stuff for this baby boy. So, like, you know, we can change diapers together. We can do this so that, you know, we can make it pretty much exciting for the child to really welcome the second baby, because he feels that, okay, it's not that the second baby is taking my mother away, but she is actually involving me, and it's a play thing.
So you mentioned about the patience, but sometimes it's actually not. Basic example is like I'm sending my kid to playgroup and she doesn't want to wear the sweater. Now it's very common, I think. All the persons would have this. So what should we do? And she understands that much. She's logical that it's outside, it's cold,
mm-hmm.
and she might get cold or cough.
Mm-hmm.
But then also she will say, no, I don't want to.
So you need to ask why. So she would have her own logic. And what's her own logic in that case, if you have done that before?
Yes, no, she says, no, I don't want
to. Yeah, so you need to tell her everything has a logic. So give me two good reasons and I would allow you to do that.
But she's like, not that much logical though. She's
turning. How old is she?
Three.
Oh, 3 year old, you can expect such things. Of course. Yeah.
And second thing is like, recently I have creative in 3 years. So no, my walls are painted with her drawings.
Okay.
So she understands that we don't have to do it, but then she does it.
You again need to see what's the consequence. What is she getting out of it? Is it like she's getting negative attention because father is constantly telling me not to do it and I'm getting attention out of that?
Yes.
Because, yeah, so even that's
me as
a, the mother probably, okay? So the rules you would tell, okay? Then you would start, when it's attention-seeking behavior, you need to really ignore the child's behavior, okay? And after a point, you would see that, you know, the child would get the point that, okay, this behavior is not appreciated. It's like cold, like there is no reaction. I'm getting no attention out of it. So the child would automatically come and start doing something. He would just check, okay, you know, let me see my mother's mood or my father's mood and all. Yeah, this is a little accepted.
In some cases,
so
the child is not bothered about the parents' behavior, how they are going to react. They still know what they want to do.
So again, you need to check, why is the child doing it? See, there could be, at times, the child would just show that, okay, I'm not bothered. But he is doing it because he knows that if I show that I'm not bothered anyways, I'll still get the attention. So that could be one of the reasons.
Sometimes,
okay?
he said, painting, I'm coloring the wall. So when a child is going, we have a color pen, he just randomly draws a line without any reason. But he does it every time.
Okay, so you can, in that case, you can make a corner for him. Okay, so you get this a lot of stuff wherein, you know, they can color, they can wash the place. Okay, there are washable colors and everything. So you can give the child a particular corner and say, this is your corner. Okay, this is where you can do whatever you want to do, but apart from this, you're not allowed to do anything. So somewhere it's like a tera bhi nahi mera bhi nahi. So you can do this, and at the same time, there is a rule that, okay, isse zyada nahi allowed hai. So, you know, the child is not directly feeling that mujhe kuch bhi nahi karne de rahe. Like, you know, it's not allowed at all. And then, of course, you need to teach the child that, okay, once you kind of, you know, see that, okay, the child is getting into the thing wherein he is at least listening to me that, okay, is corner mein main kar sakta ho, toh he is doing it in this corner only. After that, you can teach the child, okay, more appropriate behavior is this wherein you draw only on the book. So first we need to just get them to the schedule little bit and then slowly pitch in. Yeah.
My child don't like
something, he wanted to do.
Okay.
So he wanted to touch the black board, or if you jump, to touch the board. Once he touched, then he's happy. If you want to do it, don't do it.
So it's specific, is it specific to touching everything?
No, like anything. If you want to play the simple, you want to play it. If you want to open the fan, you want to do it.
Okay.
Carry it in.
Okay, so is it like you're giving up because he's really, you know, asking for it, and after a point you just give up?
If you don't fulfill, then you cry.
Exactly, you're giving up in between. So if you really, you know, as I said in the beginning, so, you know, bachcha roega, but yes, when the child is crying, 15 months old, right, you can also distract that child with something which is very interesting. So the child would cry rather than giving up. You know, you be consistent and firm. At the same time, you're not being very strict with him because he or she is just 15 months old. And you're distracting with more, you know, fun thing. Because the attention span of 15 months old is not too great. So it would be, you know, around till 2 years, you can expect that the child would have an attention span of 30 seconds to 1 minute at the max. So you can easily distract.
So you talked about distraction. Nowadays, technically, people give smartphone, tablet to their child to even now, they don't write. Like decently. Is it really good we are exposing them to tablet and smartphone?
No, basically, it's the parents' behavior to avoid, you know, something wherein they are not really willing to do because it takes a lot of patience and it takes a lot of time which they are not used to. Okay, because parenting is a difficult task. It's not that easy. Now what happens if the child is nagging too much and all, chal tab le le, baith ja, chup chup. So what are we teaching? Basically, and the child would, of course, definitely he would keep creating constantly a similar situation, because probably if I ask directly the tab from father, he's using it and he won't give me. Let me just create a situation, वैसे ही मुझे चुप कराने के लिए tab दे देंगे. So.
But how long we should distract the kid? I mean, say for example, my son, if he wants a phone, he wants a phone. If I don't give him the phone, and if I try to distract him, say, let's go out, I'll show you this and that, he will see it, he'll get distracted, and then he'll say, Mama, thank you, I will start crying.
How old?
He'll be completing 3 years this month, right?
Okay.
So, he remembers what I was crying for, and he comes up with it. And then I have to keep on talking and talking. See this, it happened like this, this happened, this came, this. And I'm just tired of talking.
Yeah, so in that case, a three-year-old, you can give a positive timeout. So when we say positive timeout, okay, so initially, definitely, we give them the clear instruction that you're not supposed to, or you're not getting it, for example. And then you distract, and the child comes back to the same point again and again. Then you say, okay, now if you do this again, it's a time for positive timeout. You won't say positive, you just say timeout. So the timeout behavior is something wherein the child needs to sit at one corner, probably which is not interesting for him, because otherwise again he'll create a situation because it's interesting. But somewhere, you know, wherein he needs to sit for a while, okay, and the mother is not going to talk. Because by the time is three, I mean the child is 3 years old or something, the attachment theory is already developed and everything. So the child wouldn't really like the mother not to talk to him. So, you know, the emotions and everything, that's something that we can use. Here.
The situation that you told, I've tried this, but my daughter backfired. She told me, I'm not going to eat because you got angry at me and you gave me a punishment of sitting in the
Yeah.
So,
how old is your child?
4 years old.
4 years, okay. So, you need to see why the child is setting up the rule at home. Okay. So, what is the leniency that the child is getting when, you know, she is kind of getting this, you know, courage to create a rule at home? So you need to see what voice tone are you using. You know, are you imposing too many things on her when she starts feeling defensive about everything, or what is it exactly? So you need to be very, you know, when you are also setting the rule, you also need to set it in a way that, you know, like I'm firm, but at the same time, mama is nice. So that's the kind of thing that you need to put forward.
My child don't like to eat. Don't like to eat cheese and chocolates and other things. We continuously keep asking why we need to eat. I tried in many ways, in social stories and I trying to say him like to become strong, we need energy and kind of stuff. But he replied me like, I'm strong, look at me, I'm jumping and other things. So I'm a little worried.
Yeah, because you are giving the evidence to the child which is going against the logic for him. Like, I can stand, I can walk, I can run. So why is mama worried about it? So, you know, we also need to see what logic are we giving. Is it like, you know, really having a base? Because what age is your child?
Four.
So by four, he can see, he can feel, he can think. So he knows, like, you know, at that time. So now you need to make, again, the eating time very interesting. You need to check why the child is having aversion towards it.
But he don't like anything.
Yeah, so why is the aversion towards eating? So you need to check on that first and make the eating thing very interesting for him.
Yes, we do that. We play, we keep saying the stories. Even we tried with different items. But
is he getting negative attention?
No.
Because, you know, probably if he's not eating, the mama is nagging, eat, eat. Papa is nagging, eat.
No, never. If we force him, he will hold, bite the mom. he likes vomiting, or I don't like.
Can he comprehend hunger?
Yes.
He comes and tells you that I'm hungry.
Yes.
So at that point of time, what happens? He eats well?
No, he is just like 3 or 4 bites of food. That's all.
Okay. And in what intervals do you give him food?
After 3 hours.
Every 3 hours?
Every 3 hours.
Okay. So what you can do is initially, okay, you can increase the interval time. Mm-hmm. Let the child feel, I'm hungry.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When the child is hungry, okay, you wait. Let the child come and tell you, Mama, I'm hungry, give me food. Okay? You give him food. Probably he would eat 3 to 4 bites. Okay? Still, let him just eat that. Get satiated. Let him go back to his activity, whatever he's into. Okay? So he would know that, yes, if I don't eat, I get stomach cramps. Okay? So what I need to do is basically, I need to go and tell Mama, I'm hungry. And what is Mama going to do? She's going to give me food when I'm going to feel better. So that's what we need to create, so that, you know, we are developing the logical reasoning of the child as well, like this.
When
we
play
with
the child, Jenny doesn't like to lose. He's okay losing to other children, but playing with me just doesn't like to lose. He can explain all social stories, everything possible,
yeah.
But just doesn't like to lose.
Okay, so did you ever ask why? Like, could you ever say why? Is it like that? So you need to see why exactly is that happening. Probably, you know, there was something which had happened in the past and he is kind of holding on to it.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to know why exactly is that happening, because in general he doesn't have a problem.
In general he doesn't have a problem.
Yeah, so why is it only with you?
Regarding phones and tablets, so there are some apps which are for brain development or for coloring and all that. We don't usually offer.
Mm-hmm.
Just to play her, like, keep quiet.
Mm-hmm.
But she likes to do the coloring on app as well.
Mm-hmm.
So is it okay to give her?
Yes, yes. For a certain while, these are a part of neurocognitive rehabilitation also. So this is going to help, of course. You know, it's not like, you know, tabs and everything are completely bad, but it goes a little abnormal when it's beyond a certain limit. So, yes, I mean, you can actually use a lot of memory games with the child. If it's a 2-year-old, 3-year-old, still okay. But then yes, we need to develop some etiquettes, eating etiquettes after 3 or 4 year old. So, you know, slowly we need to start introducing it. Because otherwise it will become a permanent habit for the child when they grow up. And we can still make the eating time interesting even without TV.
My family is pretty multilingual that way. So I was 15 months old. Now everyone who comes, grandparents and all, they speak in their own language to him.
Hmm?
So I'm concerned will that intellectually confuse him, or will it delay him learning languages, or will it confuse him in any way? Otherwise, he responds to everything. Like, we know that he's understanding signs, that he'll demand what he wants. So those kind of things are fine. But I'm confused whether, because one is South Indian and we have Bengali, and then one is a North Indian, so then it's a wide.
Yeah, but then do you see the child is developing normally, even in terms of speech development? Yeah, then there is no area of concern.
I have a 2-year-old son. We tried different daycares. You know, we actually gave 1 year time for him to settle down, but he didn't settle down in the daycare. And now next, this coming June, we have to, you know, make him ready for the preschool.
I didn't get the last point.
We have to make him ready for the preschool.
Okay. Okay.
Because he's not social at all.
Mm.
I mean, in the daycare, when we were also sitting with him for 2 or 3 hours, my husband did it, I did it, my mother did it, but he didn't settle down. So we stopped with the daycare. And now, you know, we you know, have to manage our work hours, and we are with him.
See, I'll tell you what. Yeah, so I'll tell you what. Okay, nowadays, yes, you know, kind of we send the child to a daycare and all because parents, I understand, they don't have time and all. But if you have to kind of trace back, okay, when were we put into schools? It was after the age of 3, 3 and a half, right? And we were kind of in the initial days, probably we would cry and all, and then I will be happy about going to school. Probably we won't like to miss it at all. Because that's the development that we expect out of a 3-year-old. Before the age of 3, the child is definitely going to have difficulty in being with strangers or, you know, kind of adjusting in a particular situation, which is not very, you know, he is not finding it interesting. And the only way the child can show is like either by crying or, you know, kind of throwing tantrums or being stubborn or something. Because at 2, probably, of course, you know, speech-wise as well, he won't be very able to come and tell you what exactly is he feeling or what is the problem. If it's a 4-year-old, we know, okay, this is the thing that, you know, he's not liking at school. And probably we can rectify that, or we can, you know, can take care of it because we can go and speak to the teacher or something of that sort. But now here the child is feeling. There's no problem in feeling, but he's not being able to express, and parents, as parents, we go kind of, you know, haywire a little about it, that, you know, what has happened to the child? Is he not adjusting? Is he not being social? It's not like that. Because it's not that the child is, you know, having difficulty in every social situation. It's very specific when he's going to the daycare. Now for play school again, if you want to put him to the play school, you need to prepare the child, you know, showing the fun side of going to a play school. When the child looks forward to go to that place.
From last 15 days I'm observing, he come to me, Mama, Ayush hit me.
Ayush? Oh, his Ayush?
Mama, Ayush did this. I don't know why he's lying. I never like, or he's too young to make enemy. I don't know why he's like, everything, who did this? Ayush did this, Mama. Ayush did that. Ayush hit me. I don't know why he is lying.
Is he lying or is that a fact?
No, I mean, we are at home. Who, Ayush? I don't know who is Ayush.
So first, we need to know what's happening. Because, see, we also need to be careful that, you know, our child is not getting bullied. So probably if that's actually happening at school, we need to take care. And if not, then you need to royally ignore when the child is coming and telling you such things. First, give some instruction, clear instruction that, okay, fine. So if this is what is happening, you need to be assertive and say, I don't like it. Okay? And after that, if this is repeating, you can tell that, what did I tell you? Then you get the answer back from the child. So did you do that? He would say no. See, what happened? So eventually, you kind of, you know, start ignoring later on. Because if you see that it's an attention-seeking behavior, ignore.
I asked him, where is Ayush?
Hmm.
Who is Ayush? Ayush did this.
Probably it's imaginary, but at the same time, you can also be in touch with the teacher to know, you know, not really telling her initially that something happened. You can just ask her, like, you know, is there any child called Ayush? And if something is happening, we also need to take care of that.
Okay.
we cannot really completely ignore what the child is saying. But we do it in our own way, like, you know, when we are not saying that, okay. Otherwise, if the child sees that, okay, main mama ko kuch bhi bolu, mama gets panicked and she would do this. So again, that's negative attention somewhere. It's not helping him in a positive way.
Kid does not want to talk about studies. Like, if I ask him what did you learn, he knows all the rhymes, he knows ABCD, he knows 1 to 20.
Mm-hmm.
And I was one day surprised when he was playing and he was saying 1, 2, 3, 4 to 20. And I didn't know. I asked him lots of times, did you learn something? He's like, no, nothing. He just ignored my question. And when I went to the teacher, she says he's very good, he's learning everything, he knows all the songs and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't like to tell me. So how do I make him tell me that what he learned or no, regarding studies only, otherwise he'll tell me he ate tiffin, he had dal rice, everything he'll tell me, but about studies he never said anything.
Okay, so is it like right after he comes back from school you start asking him? It's like there is a gap period and everything. Okay, so in that case what I can do is like you can again tell the child that you know what, mama loves it when you can say 1 to 10.
Sometimes we show the fear of some person or something, like my son is fear from the injection, vaccination. He doesn't like some person, like one of my friends, when I tell him his name that Gokhale Kaka will come if you don't do this. So this kind of do in front of
unhealthy. Because then we are creating a fear in the child's mind, and then later on, again, we cannot come and complain that, okay, the child is doing this, because, you know, probably years back, we created the fear in the child's mind. Yeah.
My kid is having a habit of throwing toys, so how to avoid this?
Again, behavior management. Time out? Yeah.
So my daughter has recently developed the habit of slapping her lips and constantly like she's doing like this like this and she's explained her and told her whatever he did, she's still doing that. And it has happened to many, probably more than a month.
Any signs of anxiety? Because for a lot of kids, you know, it's a sign of anxiety as well when they start, you know, picking up some maladaptive behavior, because they cannot really express, and you know, it kind of gets diverted towards maladaptive behavior. Otherwise, again, second thing is you need to check for, you know, if the child is getting negative attention out of it. Third.
Yeah, everybody starts howling. So
yes.
We will explain, and a point will come wherein the whole house is howling, like why you are slapping them, because it has become like.
Yes.
She keeps doing it, and if we say something, she'll glare and she'll give like absolutely no reaction. So one person says, second, and then by the time all four of us start howling, if we are saying and you are not paying attention.
Yes. So howling is definitely not going to help in terms of kids. Okay. So if we howl, the child will be like, okay, looking at your face, and do you really think he's going to listen, he or she is going to listen? No. He'll be in his own world. Okay, probably you know only half of the things he or she would listen. Now at that time, when what you can do is like you can tell her that, you know what, what's your daughter's name?
Ishita.
So Ishita was really pretty a month back, till that time she picked up this habit. Now Ishita is going to be very beautiful when she quits this. What is better? So, you know, let them relate to certain things. So you can also take her in front of the mirror and can show, see. But then you have given her too many instructions which she would not follow. So it has to be very simple, clear and fun. Yeah.
How do you manage the anger of a child?
Again, you need to be very firm about the rules and regulations that the child is allowed to feel angry. Because that's pretty much, you know, that's a humanly behavior. If he's not liking something, if he's frustrated, he might feel angry.